This morning, I'm reminded of a song this morning that I wanted to share with you. It says, I will lift my eyes to the mountains. For where comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper, the Lord is your shade in your right hand. The sun will not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul. The Lord will guard your goings out and your coming in from this day forward and forevermore. Let us stand this morning and sing together, Blessed be the name of the Lord, our adoration and praise this morning.
Thank you.
us are wearing these black shirts up here, and we're going to the Dominican this Friday, we leave. We're looking forward to that. And we thought we would have a word of prayer with everybody on the team who was able to come. Most people are in their own churches this morning and probably having their own commissioning services, but I see a couple have come from other churches. And so I'm going to call everybody with a black shirt, like, why don't you come on forward? And we're going to have a word of prayer. And I'm going to ask if any of my deacons are here this morning. I saw Larry and Jeff, if they would come forward as well. And I know you're not prepared for this, folks, but if you're on the mission board, I'd like you to come forward as well to come and pray for this group of people. If you're on the mission board or a deacon, I appreciate you coming forward. All right? All right. We're very excited about going down. In case you don't know, we're doing quite a lot of things. We're taking a sewing team. We're bringing down sewing machines so people can learn a skill to make themselves some money. So that is really a great thing we're doing. We're building two groups on two churches, am I right? Or they're church and parsons, two churches. So that's great. We're going to have an outreach team. I'll be part of the outreach team. And Steve will be a part of the outreach team and some others. And we'll be going door to door, I guess, and all kinds of things. We'll be handing out dignity packs and stuff like that. And we're also taking a medical team, which Shirley has been heading up. And there'll be a couple of nurses and so forth joining us. So we're doing a multifaceted mission trip. And we're really excited about it. I remember when I went to Nicaragua about 35 years ago or so. I don't remember how long. 25? Okay. I'm here with your wife. A long time ago anyways. And I tell you, it is something different to look in the eyes of some of these people and just see the poverty with your own eyes. It's not the same as watching it on TV. And this is going to bring some help. Of course, we can't alleviate everybody's problems. And we have problems in our own back doors too, don't we? So we need to be mindful of that. We as a church are sending a group of people this year. It's our turn, and we want to pray for this group. So I'm going to ask if Larry and Jeff, if you guys wouldn't mind praying for this group, why don't we give you a microphone so you can be heard, and that would be great.
Let's unite together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we know that you have commissioned this long before we have. We know that you're behind and in support and have led us to this mission. We thank you for the opportunity. We thank you for those who are going, and as always, pray for their safe trip and things to go well, whether to work with them and the construction able to be done, and most of all, that the people in the area can see that you are living in our hearts and it does make a difference in our love and our giving. Lord, we just pray that you would be with them. Use this mission as you always have, Lord. Reach out to lives, prepare their hearts for what each member has to say. And Lord, we just pray your continued blessing upon them. In Christ's name.
Heavenly Father, we just want to praise you today for bringing this team together, for giving them the opportunity to serve and giving them the means, supplying the means of all of their needs. And Father, we just pray a blessing upon them, and we ask that you would be moving already in the hearts and in the lives of people in that area, so that when the mission team gets there, you've already started the work, and may you do mighty and powerful things in and through them to bring honor and glory to your name. May this team be a blessing to all those that they encounter. Just take them and bring them safely, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Together and sing one of the great hymns of the faith. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Let us stand together. Beautiful, 94 Crown Vic. I got it from an elderly gentleman in his 90s, I think he was, and in it was a tape, and so, because there's a cassette tape in there. It happened in the vehicle, what we say. And I thought, well, I wonder what kind of music this is. So I popped it in, and I found out I had a very different taste in music than this old gentleman that gave me the car. For George's funeral, he had a request of a couple of songs to be sung, and one of them we did here as a quartet, and it's a beautiful song, and we thought we would share it with you folks this morning as well.
Just
just wait till you get trifocals. But I'm grateful we had one of these sitting around, and it'll be able to help me to see a little better up here. Let's just take a few moments and go to prayer. Father, we are so grateful for our family in the Lord, that we can come again this day into your house, and it is a joy to worship our Savior together. Lord, I am grateful that though we are one church, we are many in the Lord. There are so many churches represented in this neighborhood, proclaiming the good news that Jesus Christ came to take away our sins. And Lord, so we pray your blessing upon each church as they gather this day. And thank you for the greater body of Christ. It is so nice to know when we go away, we can feel at home. As we go to heaven in Dominican, we're going to feel like we're part of the body of Christ. What a joy that is. And we pray as we do go down there and share, Father, and do some very active one-on-one door-to-door evangelism, Father, that your Spirit would move through those of us who go to the door. And as we speak down there as well, have opportunities through translators, Lord, just use us mightily for the glory of Christ, we pray. We're certainly no better than any of those people. They are made in the image of God, just like each of us are. And we consider it a joy and a privilege to go and share with these people down there. Bless that trip, we pray. We think of those who are laid up in hospital, and I think of Jean Hovey, and I think of Lucy Hawks and Eloise, as they are all there. And Lord, we pray that your Spirit would just strengthen each one day to day. I thank you for the progress, especially in Eloise's body, and I pray that it would continue. Pray for Lucy, as she's in quite a serious condition, Father, that you would strengthen her today. Lord, we pray for our camp Shifty Hawk this morning. And thank you for the ministry that John and Richard and others who are involved in the camp perform year-round. And we thank you, Lord, and look forward to the day when we go to glory and see, because of our giving, this child has come into your kingdom. And what a day of rejoicing that will be. Pray for those missionaries today who serve you abroad and at home, sacrifice so much for your glory. Just lead and guide them, I pray, and bless them in their times of need. Lord, just open our hearts now as we come to the Word of God. May it be the highlight of our morning to hear from the Word of God. Bless them in these words, I pray in Christ's name. All right, if you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn to Luke chapter 3 with me. Luke chapter 3, and I will forever encourage you to bring your Bibles to church. Luke chapter 3, and we're just going to read a couple of verses. Verses 21 and 22. Now, when all the people were baptized, Jesus was also baptized, and while he was praying, heaven was open, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came out of heaven saying, "You are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased." You all know we're doing a series through about the Holy Spirit, I debated this week back and forth whether or not to speak on the topic that I've prepared this morning. I decided I should, because we're talking about other words that describe the Holy Spirit, and these other words, when you take them in and of themselves, can lead to some heresies, and indeed some cults have formed because they've taken these other words and make them mean something they were never intended to mean. And I suspect that you are well aware that Jesus is portrayed many times in the Old Testament in different ways, most often by the phrase, I've never forgotten it until right now. Oh, it'll come to me later probably. But we know he is proclaimed in the Old Testament, and it's really bothering me now. I can't think of that word. But anyways, he is proclaimed in the Old Testament. We saw recently, last week I mentioned, when we looked at John 3:16, how Christ was portrayed in the Old Testament through the story when God was angry with the people of Israel for their continued sin, and he sent the serpents to come and bite them, and when they looked up at the pole, they were healed from that venomous bite. And it was a foretaste of the coming Christ. And so we refer back to the Old Testament story when God also fed the people, the people of Israel, and he caused those deadly serpents to come. And there's other things as well. There's so many stories we can share about how it proclaims the coming of Christ, the burning bush, the feeding of the 5,000, and stuff like that, as the feeding of manna. And there are many types of references for Jesus, and equally there are many types of references to the Holy Spirit. But we must be careful not to take one of those descriptions and make a theology of it all by itself, because you are not doing integrity to your exegesis. You will find events, institutions, persons all point us to the Holy Spirit in the Bible. And they are often downplayed, sometimes they are overlooked, and sometimes they are twisted as well. And sometimes we aren't quite sure what they mean, to be honest, and we're afraid to admit sometimes that we're not sure, and so we ignore the text and not talk about it at all. And that is the beauty of the Word of God, that is living and active, and we'll never figure it out from beginning to end. And it's always teaching us something, and we can always learn from it. And when we don't get to the hard work of trying to figure things out, it is easy then to misunderstand what is being communicated and make wrong assumptions because of that. Now, in order to understand what we're going to talk about today, we have to wrestle with a few terms. I hate terms. I remember when we did the series on the end times, for those of you who are here, the second lesson was all about terms, about the end times. And it was like walking in quicksand, trying to get through it. It was really tough, and I know it was. But at the end of the day, all those terms made sense as we look back on the rest of the study. Our first definition is the word divine type. Now you need to hear this. A divine type is a divine illustration that prefigures a future reality. Hear that again. A divine type is a divine illustration that prefigures a future reality. And we saw that, as I mentioned just a few minutes ago, in a text in John 3:16. As we look back in the Old Testament, it was a prefigure of a future reality in the New Testament. So let's break down that definition a little bit first. To say it is divine, when giving reference to a member of the Godhead, a divine type must be divinely purposed. Unless it is divinely purposed, then it is just a regular part of history and nothing special. Some things are clearly divine types, and others are just everyday events. Some divine types would be seen in the tabernacle. And you can check that out if you have a pencil and want to write this down. Go check out Acts 7:44 and Hebrews 8 verse 5. And when it's also a divine type, when we see the wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. And you can check it out against 1 Corinthians 10 verses 6 and 11. And Adam being a type of Christ, Romans 5:14. There are all kinds of them in the Bible pointing us to the New Testament fulfillment in Jesus Christ. And it takes skill and hard work on our part to see those things, to understand them. For example, many things in Joseph's life point us to Christ. And I have read the Bible through many times, and I never got it. But Joseph's life point us to Christ, point us to Jesus. Many of the experiences with his brothers prefigures Christ's life. The conspiracy that the brothers went through to kill him, and his taking of a Gentile bride, his reconciliation with his brothers, are all divinely purposed, pointing us to Jesus Christ. In our definition, I also use the word illustration. It is a reminder that we need to enforce upon the text a one-to-one correspondence between a type and its correspondent reality or antitype. Now that's a mouthful. And what that simply means, it simply means that when a divine type is communicated, there has been a certain amount of normal history also put within that as well. The key is the divine types. The divine types are given in normal historical situations, but the divine aspects are not typical. Israel's life and history is constantly a mixture of the regular with the divine. And we need to see the divine types. And I also use the word prefigure in the definition. This simply means that there must be a separate and distinct entity that is representing the type or the antitype. Now, I don't want to lose you in the definition, so let me give you an example of what I mean here. Oil. Oil is a type for the Holy Spirit. Its use in the Old Testament is often used as a prefigure for the Holy Ghost. And we need to see that. And I love illustrations. They help us understand things much better. And to be honest, I wish I was better at communicating more and more illustrations. And illustrations help us to grasp things, it enlightens things for us. And much like Jesus using parables, he uses them to make a single point. Sometimes we try to impose upon illustrations more things that the story was intended to. So let's look at some specific representations for the Holy Spirit, such as oil. I want to begin by saying we aren't looking at depth at these this morning. We're simply doing a survey through it so that you can get an idea of how the Holy Spirit is referred to. First word used that I want to bring into your attention is the word breath or wind. The Holy Spirit is referred to as breath or wind. John 3 verse 8 says, "The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." What John is talking about is the regeneration by using the word wind. We learn a few things from this. First, we learn that the Holy Spirit's work is invisible. We can't see it. You know, we look outside and we say, "My goodness, it's a windy day today." But in reality, we don't see the wind, do we? We see the trees blowing and we see leaves falling off. We see snow blowing, usually in our driveway. And we see our garbage cans lids going down the road, which we have to chase down. But we don't see the wind. So our new birth in Christ is like that. It's invisible. And although the results of the new birth are evident to all, and we evangelicals often have lost sight of the fact that God is in the life-changing business. I've said it to you many times already. God is in the life-changing business. He wants to change our lives to be molded in the shape of Christ's life. We all, and by the way, I think it's the Mormons that are really big on calling the Holy Spirit a wind or a breath, not a person. So that's an important one. We also learn that the Spirit's work is sovereign. It is He who touches our lives. It is He who brings us to repentance. Just as the wind blows where it pleases, it's the Holy Spirit's work as He pleases. The Holy Spirit's work is God's divine purpose in His wonderful grace. But let us never cease praying for the unsaved, that God will bring them to Christ. Third, we also learn the new birth is heavenly. The new birth is heavenly. Jesus always contrasted the new birth with the old birth. The new birth is always mentioned as from above, coming down to us. Again, God wants to change our lives by the Spirit who comes inside of us when we accept Jesus as our Savior. And finally, we watch in the news in the springtime, so many of the weather things that happen down in the States, particularly of hurricanes and tornadoes that just destroy so much of the States, and not just the States, Dominican, Haiti, and some of the other Caribbean nations down there. The Spirit's work in our new creation should be equally powerful, should be equally life-changing for us. He makes us new. Now we need to live that way. And if we've come to Christ, our lives should reflect in some way, in a powerful way, that God has changed us from within. Luke 24, verse 49 says, "And behold, I am sending forth the promise of my Father upon you, but you are to stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." The Holy Spirit is referred to as clothing. I want us to notice four things about this. First off, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, they sewed some leaves together to cover themselves up. But God comes along and gives them much better clothing to cover themselves. Here God is clothing us again with a new life in Christ by the power of the Spirit. It is a better way to live, a life-changing way to live by the Spirit of God. And second, notice the protection. The Holy Spirit walks with us and protects those He covers up. Thirdly is holiness. And I've said many times already, we are called to be holy because God is holy. And that is His calling upon each of us today. And finally, notice the pictorial emblem of relationship as belonging to God and being His representative here on this earth. We are ambassadors for Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:20 says. When we finish high school and go off to universities and colleges, we graduate and they make us wear these long gowns of square hats, wherever that tradition came from, I have no idea. Somebody had some personal issues, I'm sure. And we come to Christ, we graduate from this life to a life from above. We become new people, so let's live like it. The Holy Spirit is also referred to as a dove. Now, we're very familiar with this one, of course, with Jesus' baptism, when the Holy Spirit came like a dove. He wasn't a dove, but like a dove. And it is there to remind us of the purity of the Spirit and the heavenly origin of the Spirit. Another word also used to refer to Christ, and I guess it depends on the translation you're using, but either earnest or a pledge. 2 Corinthians 1:22 says, "Who has sealed us and gave us the Spirit in our hearts as a pledge." He is a pledge or an earnest, I think is the King James Version. A pledge is a guarantee on the part of God that the believer will receive all the future promises that God has made related to salvation. And when God promises something, He never fails. The Holy Spirit is also referred to as fire. Acts 2 verse 3 says, And there appeared on them tongues as of fire, distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. Now what that looks like, I have no clue. It would be interesting to see what that would have looked like the day of Pentecost when that happened. I'm not aware of anybody on this earth who has seen that, but who knows, maybe somebody has. But it did teach the early church a few things. It taught them about the presence of the Lord. Now let's see if we compare this with Exodus. Chapter 3, verse 2, which says, "The angel of the Lord," that always means Christ. That's the word I'm looking for. The angel of the Lord. That always means Christ. There we go. The word the is key there. The angel of the Lord always means Christ. It appeared to him in a flaming fire and in the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, yet the bush was not consumed, and Moses was puzzled by it. And it shows us the approval of the Lord. Leviticus 9, verse 24 says, "Then the fire came out from before the Lord and consumed the burnt offering and the portions of fat on the altar. And when all the people saw it, they shouted and fell on their faces." It shows us the protection of the Lord again. Exodus 13, 21 says, "The Lord was going before them in a pillar of cloud by day to lead them on the way, and in a pillar of fire by night to give them light that they may travel by day and night." And finally, it shows us God's judging, sanctifying, and cleansing power. Leviticus 10, verse 2 says, "The fire came out from the presence of the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord." You may recall, for those of you who are here, we looked at Isaiah 6 last week when the angel came and touched the lips of Isaiah with the coals. And then there is John the Baptist, who said Jesus would come and baptize them with the Holy Spirit and fire. Holy Spirit is also known as fire. And the Holy Spirit is also said to seal. Now, I understand today that what I'm going to say doesn't sit well with some people, and that's okay. I agree that scriptures at times appear to teach two opposite things. And for those of us who studied the end times thing, saw there was four different approaches. How can the Bible teach four different things as all being true? And this is one of those things. Today we're looking at the word of the Holy Spirit is called as a seal. When a person trusts Christ as their Lord and Savior, they are sealed by the Holy Spirit. Apparently, the Holy Spirit is both the person who seals and the one who does the sealing. This means we are owned by God the Father. We are His child. It means you can have a surety in Christ Jesus that the Holy Spirit, through Christ, will bring us through. It means that we recognize God's authority over these things which He owns. And finally, it means the realization of all the promises and blessings of God. There's two more words I want to talk about. I'm just going to mention them very quickly because time is passing by. The first is servant. The story of Abraham's servant looking for a wife for Isaac shows in us three ways the ministry of the Holy Spirit. First, just as the servant only spoke the words that the master said, he spoke on his behalf, so too the Holy Spirit speaks on God's behalf. And we can be assured of his words. He is the servant of God. Two, the mission of the servant was to seek a bride for Isaac. So too the Holy Spirit seeks out those whom He will add to the body of Christ. The church is God's bride, Christ's bride. And finally, the servant gives gift to the bride, and the Holy Spirit indeed gives gifts to each and every one of us. Let us use them for the glory of God. And the last word I want us to know is water. Jesus compared the future ministry of the Spirit to water springing up and flowing out of the believer's life. This signifies that eternal life comes from that which was hopeless before. It means we will have more abundant life, and it means that out of the believer will flow rivers of living water. So, you can see there are a lot of names, divine types of names given and attributed to the Holy Spirit. And we see that many of these names ascribe also a specific detail of the person of whom the Holy Spirit is. And let us be thankful that the Holy Spirit has come upon us. He is our guarantee. He has sealed us to the day of redemption. And so let us be careful as we go about our daily walk to not resist the Spirit of God when He is prompting us along in life. You know, the Holy Spirit changes lives. If you had talked to many people in my home church when I was young and say, Dan Austin's going to be in ministry, I am sure they would laugh their heads off. Trust me, I'm not the same person I once was by the grace of God. And I am so thankful for that. And I have changed a lot. I confess most of my learning and changing came via a 2x4 over the side of the head. But God's grace has been good to my life, I tell you that. So we need to give our lives to Him to allow us to change and mold us. He wants to bless us so much. So trust in Him today. Let's pray. Gracious Father, we are grateful for the Holy Spirit as part of the Godhead and what He does for us. May we understand Him better as we go through this series together and begin to understand all He does for us, the gifts He gives us, the sealing of the Spirit that He gives us. And Lord, may we use those gifts to bring glory to Jesus Christ in and through the church. We pray. Just pray you watch over these folks as I go to the Dominican for the next couple of weeks. And be with them and bless them and with Robert as he shares. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I invite you to stand and sing our closing hymn together.
Thank you.
according to the power that works within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever.